Welcome, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us this afternoon. We are going to try our best to be as entertaining, as insightful as Bill Gates, but I will hopefully rely on my panelists to do that, and I have the easy job today, not saying much. I'm Meredith Rosenberg. I'm co-founder of New Advisory, which is a search and advisory firm. I do specialize in board work and particularly in ed tech, and having had the experience of working with investors to build boards, companies to build boards, and also serving on boards myself, whether it's nonprofit, university, or private sector companies, they asked me to moderate this panel of these five esteemed guests. You all have their bios. I'm sure you've read them and memorized them in detail, so we will not go through lengthy introductions, but we'll ask each of you to introduce yourself when I ask the first question. I don't know if we will have time for Q&A afterwards, but of course we're always happy to continue the conversation after the panel in the hallway. So let's first, let's dive in. When we were all thinking about what would be the topics we should discuss, we envisioned that there are three main areas. One would be about building your board, whether you're an investor or an operator. The next would be about joining a board. If you wanted to join a board for the first time, how do you go about doing that? How do you select that? And then lastly, as an entrepreneur or an operator, how do you work with your board and how do you leverage them? So our questions and conversation will center around those three main areas. So for the first question, Stacy, I'm gonna ask you this question because you're my twin today in our blue jackets and sitting next to me. As an experienced operator and now as an experienced board member, what would you say would be the most common, I'm just gonna dive right in here, the most common miscommunication points between investors who've never been operators and operators who have never been investors?
Wow, I love that question. So I've have all three of those experiences, having run TaskRabbit and reported to a board that had venture investors. I'm now an investor, and I have companies that I'm on the board of, and then I serve on the board of several public and private companies, including HP, Nordstrom, Noom, and StockX, and Joy. And across all of those, the most common thing that I see investors do is assume that the thing that they think should happen is going to take a whole lot faster than it actually does. And when you're running a company, someone from the board sends an article. Did anyone see this article? What are we doing about this issue? Well, we've thought about it. Here's the plan. Here's the launch date. And then the board member, the investor is like, okay, great. So can we just have a plan in 2 weeks? And no, it doesn't happen that way because you're running a company. And so a common mistake is if you've never operated, you don't know how long it takes to get an organization behind an idea, to execute on an idea, and succeed on an idea.
Thank you. Now you happen to be sitting in a great order for this. So Richard, as a former operator and now investor with KKR, I'd love to hear your perspective.
Okay. Well, nice to see everybody. I'm sorry we didn't get quite the audience that Bill got, but we're working on it. People still coming in. The first thing I'd say is for all of you, I think being a board member is a good aspiration right now because it seems like other than service jobs, everything else gets taken away by AI, so it's just going to be board members and service jobs. And less facetiously, though, you know, my experience, and I kind of got a long experience of board membership, public and private, and a lot in education. My first board was actually Princeton Review in the John Katzman days, way back when, and then, you know, more recently, Chegg for a long time, Teaching Strategies, Lightcast. And in those kinds of positions, in ed tech, public and private, you know, you find a few things that are salient. The first is that boards can be dysfunctional, and avoiding dysfunction, if you're an entrepreneur or a founder, is like job one in both forming a board in the first place and then augmenting that board in the second place. So what I'd say is that, you know, your first job early on is making sure your board members can help the business survive by providing capital, and typically your capital comes with board positions that are, you know, part of the deal. But then it changes a lot. And, you know, if you show me a company that's Series F or later, I will show you a dysfunctional board because those later rounds come in at different valuations with different time frames, different goals, and the noise on the board, you know, inevitably gets pretty difficult to control if you're a founder. So I think what you need to do is concentrate on a few things in board formation. You know, one is, do you like and trust the person that you're putting on the board? Often that's a funder to start out with. And is that someone you can live with for a long time? Do they like and trust you so that the decisions you make are not questioned as you go forward? And then as you do further financings or you bring in further expertise and experience on the board, how's the dynamic going to work among those people? And is that going to be a positive dynamic over time that leads to healthy conversation? Or is it going to lead in a different direction where, you know, people start to bicker about strategy and start to question your leadership and start to, you know, atomize what one person wants versus what another person wants? There's a lot of intentionality in forming a board and in augmenting that board. And the experience I have certainly goes to making a lot of this part of the planning early on, you know, who you want, what you want on the board, who's going to provide that, and staying true to that over time.
Thank you. So you brought up a lot of good points there that I will ask each of your colleagues to answer. But Matt, I'd love to go to you and think about, I've worked a lot of CEOs who sometimes appreciate having a board, sometimes distrust the investors saying they're just bringing on independent board members to keep an eye on me. And sometimes the CEO thinks, oh, I've just got to manage them and do the minimum that I can. How do you think about engaging your board and leveraging a board?
I think you need a board that you can trust. You know, being a CEO of a company, and I'm no longer CEO, by the way, I'm executive chair. So now I get to be sort of on the other side of the table. But it's a great job being CEO. It can be a lonely job. And if you have a board that is dysfunctional or that you don't trust, it just gets lonelier. Fortunately, we haven't experienced that at Newsela. I've taken great pains, as have the members of our board, to get to know each other, to speak openly with each other, to try to avoid having conversations outside of the room. And politicking, and bring those conversations into the room with a full board, and that helps to build trust. Without that trust, there, it's a lonely job, and you're just going to find yourself spending a lot of time spinning wheels.
And when you think of the board, one of the original questions I asked to the people on this end of the stage, what would you say is the biggest miscommunication point between, again, operators who aren't investors and investors who are not operators?
You know, I can't say that there's some massive divide. I think a lot of the misperceptions of the board oftentimes are the misperceptions of management. One of the ones that I've seen lately that's caused companies to go down the wrong road, including us at times, is you try to pattern match against other successful companies, but when you don't take the time to figure out what is correlation and what's causation, like hiring all these incredibly expensive engineers or executives, is that the reason why these companies were so successful, or did they just happen to do that and they were successful just because they had an amazing product in the first place or some other piece of magic? Not taking the time to really separate that out and say, like, what is really going to be driving this business, but just saying, like, hey, listen, like, this has worked for all these other companies, let's use that as our roadmap, I think has taken us and many companies in Silicon Valley and across the software spectrum down a road that is not always productive.
And Margery, I want to ask you that same question.
Yeah, so I'm an independent board member on a couple of boards. It was three until February because it was very exciting that Teachers Paid Teachers was able to do a deal with IXL, and that was so fun because we got to see people who had worked at Teachers Paid Teachers for a long time get some life-changing money, and that was fantastic. But as an independent board member, I'm not really a large investor. I'm working with private equity firms that own the company, and then I have to think about, well, what does that mean my role is as an independent board member? In my career, I've done just about everything there is to do in educational technology publishing. I helped Scholastic go from being largely a consumer business to getting a big educational footprint. So I hope that I'm bringing my expertise about how do you build a sales force? How do you think about branding? How do you think about the customer relationship? Some of the things that I feel the private equity boards that I share a seat at the table with care very much about, but they just don't have the same kind of on-the-ground experience with it. So sometimes I have to bite my tongue a little bit. And I've also had to learn about the time horizon for private equity, which is different than my experience that I've had when I've gone to board meetings in public companies. But overall, I think it's anybody out there who wants to be on a board, I strongly encourage you to do it. I think it's a lot of fun. It's really interesting working with young CEOs or not so young CEOs and thinking about how can you add value to the business planning and mix.
Thank you. Marc, how do you think about boards adding value to companies? Because I know you also work with both the companies and the investors, and you sit in the middle there.
I do, and I'm the attorney on the panel. I'm with Wilson Sonsini, and we work with tech companies all across the country, and a lot in ed tech specifically. So my job is to educate founders before they raise their capital as to how investors think and what kind of value they can add. A dollar is a dollar. So if the same two people are offering the same dollar at the same pre-money or close to it, and other terms are generally the same, really the question is, who do you want to partner with? And most of our founders have not, we do have repeat founders, entrepreneurs who are serial and do it over and over, but for those who are doing this for the first time, we spend a lot of time talking with them about how investors think and how they're going to approach their company. Once you've picked your investor, that die is cast, and you don't have you don't get to say, all right, great, I want this investor, but I want that person to be on my board. The investor gets to pick who's going to be on your board. So up front, if operational chops and expertise is really important to you, that should really be informing the fund that you're picking to start with. If it's investor, you know, capital market building and raising capital and sort of the non-operational side of it, great, then pick someone like that. Once they're on, and so we help founders think about in terms of what's the investor's thesis, what are they looking for out of this company, and I think that helps them sort of orient how they communicate with and manage and deal with their boards. You don't want them, we have seen situations where founders mistakenly think that it's a blank check. So we're just going to run really hard. They throw a plan together. They don't necessarily believe in it. They, you know, if we stay close to it, fine. But if we burn through it, we'll get more money, and we're so cool, and they like us that they're going to write us a check at a higher valuation. And then they get sorely disappointed when they realize that's not how it works, right? And the last thing an investor wants is on a Friday afternoon to get a call saying, we're going to miss payroll on Monday, and for that to be the first conversation. And I've seen that over and over and over again. So just helping them think about how investors think and who have they signed up with, I think is really important to managing then the go-forward relationship. There are fewer surprises tactically, the way they present their operating plan and how they structure their board meetings and how they communicate with directors, I think it can be informed by all of that upfront conversation.
So how do you balance the needs then of the team and the CEO and the investors? I mean, hopefully they are aligned.
Yeah.
But with what you just said, sometimes they're not, and you're trying to educate the founders on the investor perspective. So how do you balance the two of those?
How do you balance those? I don't. That's a good question.
And someone who sits in the middle of both, how do you?
Yeah. I feel like a lot of times we are the one family member that's speaking to both sides of the family. That when there's a dispute, that we're stuck right in the middle of it for later stage companies. Early on, it's very warm and fuzzy, and everyone's excited about the idea. And with every round you raise, you introduce potentially more dysfunction. And that dysfunction is just the nature of the stage at which you're raising money. So early stage, mid stage, later stage, different objectives as far as investors go. So bridging that, I think it's just more, it's a lot of conversations with our CEOs and CFOs and those who are interacting with the board about helping them understand sort of where the investors are coming from. It's not that we're advocating for the investors, right? We represent the company. That's the other thing we remind founders all the time is we don't represent you individually. We represent this whole collective of, you know, and we take our orders from the board, but just helping them understand kind of where people are coming from, I think can then address a lot of those more specific needs. So if somebody has a real operational concern, it might be that, you know, you might not need to take that to the whole board. You might need to call that one director who has that experience, who knows about that particular area, and just have a one-off. Not everything has to be a board meeting, for example, and helping them manage those lines of communication. So balancing it, it's tricky, but yeah.
I was just going to add to that is as important as picking who your investor is, it's also important who you choose as your outside counsel, because what he's talking about, a lot of outside counsel don't do, which is be Switzerland. There are going to be times when you just can't agree. You're not aligned, and you may have an independent director, and they may think that person's aligned with the CEO, so the investor doesn't want to talk to them anyway. And your outside counsel can be that person that comes in and just hears everybody's point of view. And there's almost always a through line that you can find of here's where the disagreement is, and here's some options and steps and ways to go forward. And I just remember when we were selling TaskRabbit, and our outside counsel, he came to me and said, "Stacy, this has been fun working with you, but right now in this deal, I represent the company. And so what I can do, and here's the role that I play," and it was so critical to have him playing that role throughout that transaction, because there were certainly points where people just weren't in agreement, or I didn't understand where someone was coming from. And you can't always go to the investor and ask that question, because they may have some issues going on in their firm that they don't want to talk to you about. And so maybe they'll talk to the outside counsel about it, and you'll get a version that helps you as a CEO or founder actually make a decision.
Richard, I'd love to hear your perspective on what do you do in times of dysfunction. So you mentioned that before. Marc has talked about sitting between and talking to two sides of the family that don't talk to each other. Stacy, you had mentioned relying on counsel to bridge that perspective. Richard, I'd love to hear that.
Okay, I'm not sure I love the role that I'm in of speaking to dysfunction.
You brought it up.
But I did mention it, so I'll go with it. Why not? I think board members have two fundamental duties, the duty of care and the duty of loyalty. Duty of care, which CEOs can help with by being transparent, especially with anything going wrong, because otherwise you can't exercise a duty of care, is table stakes for any board member. Duty of loyalty is complicated, because in a public company or as an independent board member, you have a duty of loyalty to the company, to its shareholders, to its employees, to communities, to a lot of people. If you are representing an investor, your first duty of loyalty is conflicted, because you have a duty of loyalty to the investor whom you represent on the board, as well as your duty of loyalty to the company, and sometimes one takes precedent over the other. And, you know, as a legal matter, although I'm not a lawyer, I believe your duty of loyalty to your investor can override your duty of loyalty to the company, and you'll still, you know, not be breaking any laws. Dysfunction comes when those duties are in conflict with one another, where what's good for you and your investment is not necessarily great for every other investor, and is not necessarily great even for the CEO of a business, or for some of the employees of the business, or perhaps the suppliers or customers of a business, because, you know, perhaps you are in a position where you can make a ton of money because you got in early with a strategic transaction where certain other investors may be losing money because they got in late and they're not particularly happy with that transaction, and that creates dysfunction on a board, and that creates situations where things can get testy, and you start reading the docs about what rights you have and what rights you don't have. What you really want as a CEO in this case, or as a board member that's an independent, you know, trying to bring the two sides of the family together, is a holistic perspective that brings everyone's points of view together. These things are always compromises. you know, and there's always a solution. And you know, my experience is that when you have a good enough board, they'll always come up with the appropriate solution, and no one gets absolutely slammed. Even if the papers allow them to be slammed, they still, you know, end up having a dialogue where, you know, everyone gets something out of a tough situation. And I think when you have the right people, we talked about like and trust before, in terms of you're trusting who you put on the board and they trust you, often the CEO is the person to suggest these solutions, and the board ends up kind of corralling around them. And you know, even if it's a tough situation, you fight your way through it. And so, you know, this goes to what everyone has said, selecting the right people, making sure when you take the money, it's not just, hey, this is a dollar and 1 cent, but the person's kind of an asshole, but it's still 1 cent more. Think about that. You know, you're looking for maximizing not your value when someone's putting money into the company. You're looking to maximize the value when everyone takes their money out of the company. And it can be two very different equations there. And I've certainly been, you know, in the situation where our capital was not the highest dollar, but they took us, you know, because they thought we were just a better fit and had a better time frame and had a better set of capabilities that we could bring to a company, you know, as KKR or as Bertelsmann before that or whoever. I think that's going to be true in every situation you guys see as a founder or as a potential board member. You know, you're going to have choices, and you know, you need to think a little bit longer about what the exit paths are and what everyone's interests are at the end of the day, rather than what maximizing that one sort of token value of a you know, of a valuation today is.
Can I mention something on that, about that? So planning ahead 2-3 steps is, and thank you for the plug for outside counsel. We just met, so I'll send you something nice after. Planning ahead is extremely important, and preparing your founders and your operators to looking, you're always looking 12, 18, 24 months on your plan, right? That's a regular occurrence. Every board meeting, you're revisiting the plan. But I just remember an experience I had with a young CEO who was ready to sign a term sheet with a very prominent later stage investor at a $900 million valuation. And so, of course, everyone's excited because that company had gone from 60 to 150 to 300, and now, you know, here it is. And I remember talking to him. I was at a conference, and I was like, oh, that's great. But, okay, you just signed up for, if you sign this, you are signing up for a $3 billion company. He says, well, what do you mean? I said, well, that investor is going to expect at least 3 times their money. So my question for him was, are you ready for that? Are you personally ready to go for that? Do you have the drive? Do you feel like the company can get there? Because, you know, everyone's thrilled. I'm almost a unicorn, you know, and that's cool, and you can put it on LinkedIn, and it's great, and you get a lot of praise for it. But you are signing up for a real slog in most cases. And so that put it in perspective for him. He said, yes, yeah, I'm ready to do it. I said, okay, because now you have investors who would be thrilled to sell today. They would be thrilled to sell at $900 million. You have other investors who would be thrilled to sell at $1.2 or $3 billion. And you have some investors now who have just written very large checks who will not be happy unless you get to 2.7 or $3 billion plus. Are you ready for that? And can you manage the room? Can you manage those different expectations? And can you get everyone aligned around that plan? So he should not find that out for the first time 12 months later when he's now in a position where the company's flat or down or up. He should be going into that, in that case he was, with a plan directly speaking to that. That company, if you know, were to have a successful exit, it literally would make a fund. I mean, you have your early investors who literally could go raise another 2 or 3 funds on that one exit. You have another investor who's thinking, well, if I get 3x, that's a double, triple, I'll take it. And just, there's no right or wrong to any of those approaches, but just understanding that dynamic going into every board meeting and every conversation from that point forward is really important.
Yeah, and that speaks to how boards evolve over time, right? At different stages, it's not just the investors, it's not just the management team, it's how your board evolves, and you need different kinds of board members with different expertise at different stages of the company, whether it's growth, seed, growth, pre-IPO, public. Right, because it does. They have different expectations, as Stacy said at first, different impatience, right? They think things can just get done faster and they just can't. So,
And early stage investors are more dreamers. They dream right alongside with founders. They see the big vision. They know it's a gamble. It is. It's a calculated gamble, and they know that this may go big. It may flop. It may be something in between. Later stage investors, Excel spreadsheets, you know, tracking ARR, tracking everything to the dollar cost. Although it's more of a mechanical exercise at that point because the company has proven itself at some level, and now it's executing. And so it's not so much dreaming anymore. It's let's charge ahead on these different paths. So you have a room full of different people with different perspectives, and again, understanding that is helpful.
Well, can I give a shout out to the end of the room here? Because what, and I, if I can ask a question. So one thing that everyone knows when you get a business plan, whether it's, you know, seed or growth or anything else, and there's one thing that's not gonna happen, that business plan is not gonna happen, right? Everybody knows that. So you're going to need to have a set of capabilities, not just your CEO, but on the board, that people who can help you, if it's a pivot, it's a pivot. If it's, you know, changing the nature of some sales activities, some go-to-market activities, some product activities, et cetera. We have two people, you know, at the end here who've done a lot of that. And so I'm kind of curious, now that you've switched into board roles from operating roles, how you think about that.
Yeah, so I'll just give you an example of something that I brought, I think, my expertise to. This was at Teachers Pay Teachers, and we started a business of doing a subscription that we were selling to schools. And the CEO had an idea about what he thought that subscription should cost. And he called it, he had consultants come in, and they reaffirmed everything he said, of course, so that they could get hired again. And I felt that it was an unrealistic idea. I thought it was way too much. And I started talking to him about what I believed to be the subscription cost of other competing products, which nobody had done very much work on. And I was trying to do this in a positive way, you know, but it was material to him because we had a big difference in what he thought he could get and what I thought he could get. So he went out at his price, and we got quite a bit of resistance, and we ended up at my price. Now, yes, I was right, but maybe he did the right thing, you know? So that's the kind of thing where you're an independent board member. I think the board for Teachers Pay Teachers, the owners were mostly Spectrum in California. I thought we had a great board. We really got along well. It was fun. But then if you're an independent board member, you have to figure out the places where you can come in and say, based on my experience and what I've done, and then you do your best to get your point across, and you back down when it's not going to happen.
Matt?
I'm thinking back to a conversation that I had with Richard when he said to me, he first became an investor in the company. He says, I won't be able to help you much right now when you're at like 20 million in revenue. Come talk to me when you're at 200 million in revenue. And but that sort of self-awareness of the board of when their knowledge is relevant was terrific. And it's not something that all board members bring to the table. They think that their expertise is, it's just like CEOs or other executives. They think that their expertise is relevant at every single stage of the company. And you kind of have to temper that. Like they're smart people. They're always bringing something interesting to the table. But taking it on blind faith when they just hadn't been there at either a stage that's as early as yours or a stage that's as late as yours. And what Richard was saying is true. Like all investors, you know, especially venture investors, will discount it in their minds. But the perspective that the investors bring in who are on your board at various stages differs. Like the venture investors, they are the dreamers. They love being a part of that mission. They just like want to have the feeling of being part of a startup. You know, growth investors have some of that spirit, but they're looking for that public liquidity event on a sort of a shorter horizon, and they're willing to take maybe a little bit less of the returns that those venture investors if one out of 50 deals hits, that's great, but it's got to be $1 billion. It's got to be $1 billion hit. You know, I've been toying with the idea of writing an essay called "On Overpromising and Underdelivering," because like the American startup industry was built on overpromising and underdelivering, but you got to calibrate it for the stage of the company when you're bringing on investors, when you're talking to the board, when you're bringing on venture investors. Every single plan, like your 3-month plan, 1-year plan, 5-year plan, has got to be wildly unrealistic, and they will discount it. Once you get into the growth stage, your 1-year plan, you better hit that plan. But beyond that, I think it's sort of out the door. And then, I don't know, we're sort of not beyond that yet. So I don't know what to do at the next.
Private equity, just keep hitting your plan.
Just keep hitting your plan, exactly. Or if you're public.
So that. I think you said under-promising, over-delivering, right? Make sure I got the...
Over-promise
and under-delivering. Yeah. Although you do want to under-promise and over-deliver. But what would you say, though, now as a board member, what do you wish your executives were more transparent with you on? What do you wish they always told you in that promising and delivering equation? What do you want them to tell you? What are they not telling you? What do you want them always to tell you? Executive teams.
I like getting heads up on thinking. You're not an operator when you're on the board of directors, and you have to be hyper aware that you are not an operator. I guess there are boards of directors that specifically come in to play sort of quasi-operating roles, but for the most part, they are not operators. I am not an operator in my board role. I need to be incredibly aware of that. I could bring in expertise. And on the flip side of the equation, I'm not asking, I don't want them to ask me for permission for everything. Or really, pretty much anything except an M&A opportunity. But a CEO coming to me and saying like, "Hey, I've made this decision. It's really big. I'm explaining to you why." Just that upfront conversation is something that I always hope executives will bring to the table, and they don't always because nobody wants conflict, right? If you bring something to the board and like, what if they don't like it? Yeah. But the answer to that is not to just like tell them after the fact or sweep it under the table. Just, you know, just like gird yourself and say what you're going to do and stand behind that.
Stacy, what would you add to that? Because you've been a CEO and now independent board member.
I think that CEOs generally hold back on people issues that are going on in the company that probably should be told to the board like sooner rather than later. And it's often the case they come in and say, "Oh, this person is a disaster." We're like, "Wait, they were here like 3 months ago and you were singing their praises. Like, we're ready to fire this person and bring in this other person." Like, hold on, you didn't bring us along in this. And we get so focused on the metrics and hitting your plan and hitting the target and the strategy and the deals and the partnerships, and you forget about the people. And then the board sort of rejects a person, and you're like, "Wait, my board didn't support this hire or didn't support this issue where you didn't do the work to bring them along, that there was a people issue, there was a need to hire somebody." So that's the biggest gap that I usually see.
So I can't believe we only have about 5 minutes left, which is very surprising. I saw some nodding in the audience when I mentioned one of the topics before was how do you join a board? So just in our last couple of minutes, this is a rich discussion, but I would love to hear each of your perspectives on what advice would you give to join your first board, aside from engaging with a person like me who works to find board members? What would you do? What's your advice?
Oh, that's nice.
How
talk
do you
to
find
you.
Yeah, I was
board
say
members?
You're, I would Clearly. Call you. Yeah.
Call me. But aside from that, what's your advice?
So my first board, which was HP, the context for that is that they were splitting the company back in 2015, which created several board seats, like 6 seats on the board. So that gave me more opportunity to get a seat than if it was just 1 seat. So number one, find a board where they're building a board you're more likely to get an opportunity to join that board because there's going to be multiple slots. The second one is to get to know recruiters who are very effective at creating boards and bringing people onto boards and have those relationships. So that's a huge piece. And the third piece that people don't talk about as much anymore because we've done a good job on diversity or women on boards is like, is the relationships. You have to, I told everybody that I knew that I wanted to be on a public company board. They said, what kind? I said, Fortune 100. They're like, really? How are you going to make that happen? I was like, I don't know. I'm just letting you know. I'm stating my intention. And I ended up being at a conference not unlike this one, where somebody got a call, and they got a call to a recruiter who got a call to HP, and that's how it happened. And so I do think being very vocal with your network about your desire and your intention to serve on a board is really important.
I just want to underscore that because I got on, Teachers Pay Teachers was the first board to put me on, and I got close to Adam Fried, who was the CEO then, and I wanted to be on a board, and I'd like to get on another board now that Teachers Pay Teachers has had a transaction. So I'm not shy about it. I'll say it to people, you know. And I think you have to say it. You have to build your relationships. If there are companies out there that you really like and are interested in, I think you should get close to them, even if you don't get on their board. It's a great opportunity to network and relationships.
Okay, there's one surefire way. Just be the lead investor. Then you will get on the board.
Noted.
You know, or you can be CEO for 10 years and then step back. That's okay. Another way.
Buy your way onto the board.
I think...
It's cheating.
I think, I'm sorry to be facetious, but we do have three people, you know, on this panel who are former CEOs, and there is a premium on having former CEOs join boards or be on boards because that level of experience is kind of unmatched in terms of giving a sitting CEO the right kind of advice. So as an independent, if you're a former CEO, it's a pretty good card to play. Secondly, I think to repeat what's been talked about before, your network is how you get a board. You absolutely want to be networked with executive recruiters who do board work, but you want to be networked with everyone else who is on boards or with companies and hearing about positions, et cetera. That is, you know, kind of table stakes if you want, you know, if you're not on any boards and you want to join your first board. The truism here is that people like people with board experience to go on a board, like any job. Oh, you have experience doing that. Well, let's get that person. So it's the first board that's the hardest. Once you're on a board, once you were on HP, God, everyone was calling you to be on their board after that, I'm sure. So it's, you know, it takes a lot of intentionality to do that first one, and then it's a lot easier after that because you've got that card.
Marc,
thoughts? Yeah, so I work with startup companies all the way through private mature companies, and so our companies around the Series B or C financing are looking for independent directors. Early on, founders don't want to give up any control at the board level, so it's usually two founders and a representative of the investor. In the B round, you might have an independent slot, but my experience is that slot goes empty for quite a while because companies have a hard time finding at that level really good independent directors. So if that's something you're interested in, for example, I represent GSV on a lot of its investments. I would be contacting the GSVs of the world, the funds that are out there investing in the companies that you're interested in, and letting them know that you're interested, letting them know your background. Those investors are often the ones who will present independent directors to the board for consideration. And they do need to be independent. They can't have an affiliation with the fund or the company. But I know there is, that's an area where I think a lot of our companies lack really good candidates. And I think those a lot of,
you should call me.
Come from the funds. That's right. And pick the funds that are invested in things that you're interested in and go start talking to them and tell them you're interested. They're managing 10 to 20, 30, 40, 50 companies. And I'm sure there would be opportunities there.
Thank you. Yep. Okay, Matt, anything else to add aside from be the CEO and step back in terms of getting on your first board?
I'm on my first board.
Well done.
And I guess I look forward to others, but I enjoy being a board member after being in an operating role. It's fun to bring that knowledge to sort of the other side of the table.
All right, well, thank all of you so much for being here today. Thank you to our audience. Appreciate the time. And again, we are we were not able to take questions, but very happy to continue the conversation. We'll just do so out in the hall so we can get ready for the next panel. All right, thank you all so much.